to put it within normal terms, but it's kind of nervous up here, so I might use a little bit of jargon. Particulate matter, that's soot from this facility. Potential emissions are right around 135 tons per year. The control technology that they will use to control the soot emissions will be a fabric filter baghouse. Fabric filter baghouse is very common, and it has a very high level of emissions control efficiency. How they would be demonstrating compliance with this and what are the monitoring requirements. And in addition to initial stack testing, they would be required to do periodic monitoring or scheduled monitoring to make sure they're complying with their limits, to make sure their control devices are operating in an acceptable manner. In this particular case, they're going to have what we call continuous opacity monitoring system. It's a little device, I won't say little, but it's a big device that's continually measuring the opacity, which is the thickness, the darkness of the smoke that's coming out of there. SO2, sulfur dioxide, they have chosen a limit of 247 tons per year. I mentioned before that the TSD threshold is 250 tons per year. How they're going to comply with that is the use of sorbent injection. I mentioned before the limestone injection, where the limestone gas and carbonate reacts with the SO2 molecules, basically precipitates out gypsum and reduces the sulfur dioxide emissions. They're going to comply with that regulation. I think right now we have it down as a continuous emissions monitoring system. That's what I have in this particular slide. And that's what's in draft permit as we speak. For NOx. NOx is nitrogen oxides. Once again, 247 tons per year, just below that 250 tons. That's what's required by law. They're going to put on selective catalytic reduction, which is a catalyst using probably some sort of rare metal, which reduces the nitrogen oxide emissions in the same general manner as the catalytic converter on your car does, more or less. And they will be installing a continuous emission monitor for the NOx emissions as well. And that's going to be taking readings at a minimum of once every 15 minutes, and that's required by law, that continuous means once every 15 minutes. A lot of these take readings on a once per minute basis. Carbon monoxide, once again, a 247 tons per year limit. Right now we have them using an oxidation catalyst, which takes that the carbon monoxide emissions and breaks that down to CO2. And also, very similar to the way a car catalytic converter works. And we have that also down as a continuous emission monitoring system. For volatile organic compounds, I've got here VOC. Volatile organic compounds are the organics that will be either formed or remainders of what's in the wood that come out. And we see VOCs in everyday things like paint or aerosol cans, hairspray, things like that. Potential emissions is going to be about 60 tons per year, well below the threshold of 249. They'll use that oxidation catalyst as well to help control those emissions. There's really what we have proposed for contesting monitoring is going to be using these SIMs for the CO for the carbon monoxide to make an assurance that the oxidation catalyst is working for the VOC as well. Lastly, I want to point out that the major hazardous air pollutant that I mentioned earlier. In this particular case, the one that's going to be the one of main concern for us is HCl, nitrogen fluoride. Potential emissions are 8.2 tons per year. They're going to be using that sorbent injection that I mentioned earlier, which also controls SO2 emissions, to get that number down to below 10 tons per year. A lot of questions I think people have about the burning of the sludge. Once again, I do want to point out that the wood fire is going to be about 600 million BTUs per hour. The sludge firing rate is right on 4 million BTUs per hour, so it doesn't make up a large portion of the raw material that will be going into this facility. But I know that it's a concern to folks, and so I want to kind of go over, based on EPA right around 4 tons per year. Carbon monoxide, right around 5 tons per year. HCl and all other HAPs combined, less than 1 ton per year. Then want to just kind of talk about some other biomass fired facilities we have around Georgia. There's plenty of them around here. Georgia Power Plant Mitchell over in Albany. They have proposed to convert their coal-fired boiler, which is right around 100 megawatts, turn it to a biomass fired facility. In addition to that, we have six other fairly recently permitted biomass power plants that have been permitted around the state, all similar in size, roughly somewhere between 30 to 100 megawatts all around the state. We have one over in, it's in Clay County, is another facility that's a little bit bigger, permitted to be a little bit bigger than this one here. That's Yellow Pine. I did want to point out that all paper mills burn scrap wood to generate energy. The one right here in town does, the ones over on the coast. They've got the wood there. It's a good source of fuel for them. And so I just want to point out that paper mills are, burning wood for energy is not new to this particular project. Okay, I want to go over where we are in the status of the air quality review. Permit, we did post the permit online as a courtesy to folks. Because this is not a PSD or a Title V permit yet, typically we would not post that permit online. But because we had public interest, we went ahead and did that. The permit is still in rough draft form. I have not done my review on that yet. I'm not sure if John's completed his review on that permit or not. So we're not getting ready to issue this permit tomorrow. We've still got some work to do on it. But I wanted to give you an example of what the permit may be looking like. Draft permit is fairly similar to the ones we have for other biomass plants. Some of the names we have for those, Greenway, there's a proposed Greenway facility in LaGrange near Atlanta. Lamar County, which is just north of Macon. Decker, which is over in